for your big Basta visit.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, that little thing.
That little thing. That's what Krista says every night.
Oh, our inductees have joined us. Nicole has joined the party.
Hi, Nicole. Welcome.
That was a bad joke, Andy.
Hi.
I know.
Hi, Brett. Welcome.
There we go. Marilyn is the fire tablet.
Hi, guys. How are you?
Aussie.
Hi, Aussie. Good to see you.
How are you? Just blowing my wine.
Good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm good. And you?
I'm better now that your face is on my computer screen.
Well, that's a sweet thing to say.
Nice to see you, Nicole. Glad you could join us from Big Bear.
Thank you. We just got back from a hike. It was great. A little bit of snow on the ground.
I'm jealous. Nice. Well, good. Hey, that reminds me. We should talk to Nicole about our hiking fundraiser, our hike-a-thong.
I would love that.
I will reach out to you after the meeting.
Perfect. Thank you.
Actually,
Keith, great news on Santa's crawl.
It is. Yes. Yeah, it's making progress, but it's got a long way to go yet.
Way to go, man.
It's a lot to do yet.
I put some of my coffee down. I probably use a spoon. So how's everyone's week been?
So far, so good.
Yeah, looking forward to Easter.
Yes.
We went to the flower fields on Saturday. Gorgeous.
Oh, wow. I love that. We're going in about 10 days, Fred. Was it beautiful?
Absolutely. But they did not practice social distancing at all.
Oh, that's too bad.
Yeah, I had to mask up, but not distance.
Huh.
Next time, bring an accordion.
Right. That would create distance.
Oh, or not take a shower for a week. That would do it.
Also,
I think people are getting a little loosey-goosey here too fast.
Yeah, right? I agree.
No, there are only 22 people in the call today.
So far, we're going to get more.
Just going to say, as much as we all hate the masking and social distancing, it served us well. And I think, I mean, when we look at our flu season, which is non-existent, you can see that those things work. So happy to continue to wear the mask. And
Yeah.
We are vaccinated, but still.
Yeah.
We go out and we take the mask down.
Yeah. I'm hoping to be able to sign up for my shot tomorrow or Thursday.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
That, yeah. That's the problem. You're too young for it.
No, he's. I was going to say, now tell me. Young folk can sign up, which is awesome.
Right.
Yeah.
Kurt Beyer, it's good to see you. Hello.
Hi, Kurt. Thanks for coming today.
Hey, everyone. How are you?
Good.
Good. Good.
Johnny Watson.
Hey, Sandy. How are you?
I'm well. Thank you.
Yeah, you're looking well.
Did I say hi to Steve? Steve, we see that you're here. Hello.
She's ignoring you.
He's shy today. He's already been at one meeting this morning.
Right, but he looks damn good right now, so. We have Rachel and Vaughn have joined us. Rick has joined us. Dan Sunquist looking fine. Did I say hi to Chirito and Jill and Bill?
Good afternoon, Vaughn.
Let's see, who all am I missing? Hey, look, there's my mind. It's missing.
What's new?
Right.
Oh, you're a crazy group here.
And Mr. Dan Sanquist is there.
Hi, yep. How are you doing, Aussie?
Very good. How are yourself?
I'm doing well too, thank you. Oh, Mr. Fun Guy is good to be joining us today.
Hey,
good to meet you on Saturday, Roberto.
Roberto is there.
Yes, he is.
Hi, and Sandy, hi, Jill. Hi, Ron Smith. Jill Campbell.
Saying hi to Ron Smith and Mr. Minnell.
Hi, guys.
Lots of additions.
Oh, look, Ron Parker's joined us too, and Bernadette.
Oh, hi, okay. Bernie.
Hi.
Oh, here we go, admitting. Here. Oh, my.
Hey, Ron.
Hey, Jill is joining us today.
Join. There's Dan Gensler. Welcome. Marilyn is back. Kristen Bush, hello.
Hi.
Well, we're going to miss our fun son expert. He's on vacation.
Oh. He's not allowed to go on vacation.
Oh, yeah. Who's going to be singing the fun song today?
Christine.
Oh, of course.
All right.
Of course.
Yeah, whoops. Hi, Jill. Miss you all. Chirito, not sure if I know how to still put lipstick on, Chirito says. Nice.
It's been a long time, you know?
It has.
With those masks, you don't need to, so.
I'll help.
There you go. I don't want to see what that's going to end up looking like. All right. It is 12:02 and we have everybody who's involved in the meeting. Hopefully we'll get some more adding in here shortly, but we will start. It is the 30th of March. Yesterday was actually the National Vietnam Veteran Memorial Wall celebration. I hope a few of you at least thought about that. Besides me, but you know, I'm just weird that way.
That was my war.
Was it?
Yeah, I'm a Vietnam veteran.
Thank you for your service.
Thank you.
Yeah.
All right. So now I'm not distracted. We can ring in this week's meeting. All right.
Was that a head knocker?
That was. Mr.
I'm veteran.
Mr. Joe, how are you? We're going to let me mute everybody. Oops, sorry. Stop share. Mute all except for Joe, who will have to unmute himself. And let's start with our invocation.
Wonderful. Our invocation today is a prayer for our leaders. Dear God, would you give our leaders wisdom, discernment, and strength? Keep them healthy, safe, and rested so they can guide us through this time. Give our government leaders wisdom and how to stop the virus and stabilize our economy. Give our spiritual leaders your discernment on how to meet the people's needs as they glorify your name and encourage the church. Give our medical leaders insight into how to stop the virus, strengthen their resolve, and honor their hard work in creating a treatment for COVID-19. Give our civic leaders inspiration, courage, joy, and strength to meet the needs of our community, and help us as leaders in our communities to display courage, hope, generosity, and kindness. Amen.
So I just want to say hi to a couple people who came in the, as I was trying to get organized. Chip Lansing, welcome. And Doug Moyer's joining us. And we had Colleen and Krishna and Royce Moore come in. Thank you for joining. And there's Susan. Yay, we're going to get to Susan here in a moment. Susie. But let us start with, or go move on here to our pledge. Sandy, would you like to start that? Do you want me to mute everyone? Susie.
Or okay, not Susie. I'm unmuted.
There you go. Sandy is unmuted. Go ahead.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. So last week's patriotic song.
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He hath loosed the fateful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Seen him in the watchfires of 100 circling camps. They have builded him an altar in the evening dews and damps. I have read his righteous sentence by the dim and flaring lamps. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Gospel written burnished rows of steel. As ye deal with my condemners, so with you my grace shall deal. Let the hero born of woman crush the serpent with his heel. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Has sounded forth the trumpet that shall never call retreat. He is sifting out the hearts of men before his judgment seat. Oh, be swift, my soul, to answer. Oh, be jubilant, my feet. His truth is marching on.
Glory, glory, hallelujah.
Christ was born across the sea with a glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us die to make men free. His truth is marching on.
Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory,
coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He hath loosed the fateful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on.
Yes, Joe, truly. Oh, Nick Sulis met her. That's, I am so freaking jealous, honestly. That would have been amazing. And Justin, yes, the backup baritone is just mind-blowing, ain't it? All right, so welcome to the Zoom. We have several guests today. For the last time, Nicole Estrada is a guest. She'll be inducted a little later today. Welcome. We have, where'd we go? Let's see. Kristen Bush is here again. Welcome, Kristen. Welcome, welcome. And let's see, I thought there was one more. Well, obviously, we have our visiting Rotarians. We have Susie, we have Dan, and we have Brett, and we have some strange guy named Steve. Welcome all. And Ozzy, you're up.
Howdy, we're glad to have you here. Welcome, we sing a loud and clear. Relax, enjoy the program. I'm wondering.
Oh,
come back.
Morning.
See us again.
You can't do that. You can't.
I just started, don't worry.
Yeah. All right, so. Let's take a look at our calendar with shortening up the weekly calendar here because it was pointed out to me that we're jamming too much into this slide. So let's talk about April 6th. We have Blake Steinecke, who is a college student graduating this year and a visually impaired hockey player. Really an amazing inspirational story. The 10th is District Training Assembly. The 13th is Second Serve, an innovative youth-led charity. On the 20th, we have, and the 27th, we're going to be giving out our community grant recipient presentations. April 8th is also our second hikeathon. It will be around, it's going to be over by Lake Hodges on the southeast side. I don't know if you remember, we had a program about a year ago, maybe a year and a half ago, about the petroglyphs, at the Indian paintings on the rocks. Yeah. This is where that hike is going to be. So that's pretty amazing. And then we have Haven House on the 7th and the 21st and District Training Assembly on the 10th. And Ryla is on the 21st. All righty. Moving on. Do we have any member moments? All right. I'm not seeing anyone raise their hand or say anything. So we'll move on. Christine in the wild.
Hi, Christine in the Wild. For our guests, Andrew started last year, the Rotarians in the Wild, and we've kind of spread it out to be Rotarians and their families. So we're seeing what's going on out there in the world. This is Rachel Currington's daughter. Congratulations, Abby, getting into UC Berkeley. Next.
Yes.
Oh, my goodness. This is the new Goodwill in Escondido, and we have our own Mayor Mack and Council Member Jose Garcia. So that's, that's a great addition to the community. Oh, I've been seeing this on Facebook quite a bit too. This is the opening of Barrel Republic off Grand. They put on Facebook some beautiful pictures of the complete interior. And just as a starting point, there's 50 serve yourself, beer taps. So I believe a Rotary Social is in our future at this new restaurant. We need to support our local businesses and brewery for sure.
And I noticed that Joe was one of the first Rotarians there. I'm impressed. Thank you, Joe.
Yeah, the soft opening. Yeah.
Right. Was it good?
People of action.
Okay, so I'm gonna, before we move on to the next in the wild, it's actually this Saturday is the hikeathon, the 3rd. Yes, I don't know how I got the 8th. I guess 3s and 8s look alike. So this Saturday, join us at 8 a.m. over at Lake Hodges. All right, let's move on to the next in the wild. This is yours, Christine, and I'll try and add this picture real quick, okay? I always mess this up. All right, so who is come on, computer function.
We can do it the next time, Andy. Don't worry.
Okay. All right.
We've got a busy agenda.
Right. It was a very sweet picture, though. It was Christine's daughter catching a fish.
Granddaughter.
Oh, that's right. Granddaughter. there we go. All right. So let's see. Let's go back to this. All righty. Nope. So last Saturday, we did the cleanup, the Adopt a Highway cleanup. And you've probably seen some of the pictures on Facebook and people sharing them. But the most amazing thing was this. This is Dan Sunquist, and I found some good money, right?
Well, those are $100 bills.
$100 bills, right?
He found them.
All I can say is after a very ugly incident at Home Depot where some wild words were thrown around about fraud in 10 to 20 years. Anyhow, I've decided I'm going to donate this to the foundation instead of buying a lawnmower. on a completely unrelated note, does anyone know a good criminal defense attorney that deals with... Oh, sorry. A friend. Asking for a friend. So if you can't tell, honestly, so the joke there is that these are not real $100 bills. I wish.
Oh.
They're slightly oversized. Slightly oversized.
We found one once before, and it was clearly counterfeit.
Oh, wow.
Clearly is a, you know, that's debatable. All right, Justin, how are you? You want to talk about your next fun day?
Justin.
Yes.
There we are. Hi, Justin.
You want me to talk about the hike this Saturday?
Well, if you want to talk about that, this was about your next PLA.
Production.
No, at the winery.
The 28th.
Oh, yes. April 28th, we are resuming our open mic event at Forgotten. For all of you old timers like Aussie, that's Ferrero's Winery, Forgotten Barrel Winery. 6 o'clock on Wednesday evening, and it'll be the last Wednesday of every month. It's free, no cover charge, but you do need to make reservation because seating will be limited because of social distancing and other COVID protocols in place. But I'll be playing. I have about 9 singers lined up. We'll be doing opera, operetta, musical theater, jazz standards, Latin. Really a fun evening.
And I will attest that this, even if you think you don't like opera, this is an amazing event and you should RSVP. Just, it is so impressive. The voices are just mind-blowing, especially in that room. And
it's not going to be in that room.
Oh, are you gonna play Aussie?
Yes, but it's not going to be in that room because they are trying to, you know, separate people. So it's going to be in a patio, I guess.
Yes, right. It'll be outside for now.
Well, that'll be a new interesting experience then. Anyhow, I recommend that.
And there was a question on chat.
What's that?
There was a question on chat. Nick, was that you that talked about the URL? If you just go to Forgotten Barrel's webpage and click on events, you can find the reservation form there.
Very good. Do you want to talk about the hike-a-thon then, since we brought that up?
Sure. This Saturday is our second hike. Our first hike, it was Alex and me and Dr. Nick Sulis. And Alex and I were barely able to keep up with him and his talk about the Fauci. So come join us. It's great fresh air fellowship.
And it was actually four of us. It was Dr. Nick Sulis, Justin, me, and Dr. Fauci.
Dr. Fauci.
Yeah, Dr. Fauci. Yeah, if you want to look at our pictures there on the Rotary Facebook page, go ahead and you can see Dr. Fauci hiking with us.
And I will say that this is a relatively easy hike. I've done this one myself, and I will be joining you on Saturday. It is pretty flat all the way around. So even if you think you can't hike, come out and join us. So today we get, this is my first time I get to do this year. This is pretty fun. We get two inductions today. The first one, I'm going to actually introduce Krishna Cabra, and then Keith Rickenbacker will introduce Nicola Strada, his sponsoree, mentee, I don't know, what do we call it? So we're so excited. Brief introduction of Krishna. Say hi, Krishna.
Hello, hi. My video is on, but I can't see myself. I'm actually in the museum, so if you guys can see me, yep. I'm sitting in front of a whole bunch of kids' books.
We can see you, and you look fantastic.
Great.
So Krishna is an avid triathlete, a certified parent educator, and also a mom of two who periodically gets to inject large doses of joy in her life, teaching meditation to kids. She got her bachelor's in management science from the University of Manchester, which for those of you who don't know, that's actually in England. And a master's in international relations from the University of Bristol, and has studied disruptive strategy and innovation at the Harvard Business School. Krishna has over 20 years of insight, innovation, and marketing strategy in corporate world. As a part of two large agencies, she's led global innovation and marketing initiatives at some of the world's largest brands. She focuses on disruptive brand strategies and client growth. She holds a deep passion for entrepreneurship and understands what it takes to grow an organization. Having previously served on the board of directors of San Diego Children's Discovery Museum, Krishna joined the museum as its new executive director on the 31st of August of 2020, and quickly took on roles of team leader and visionary during the dynamic months of the pandemic. And I have to say, what a challenge, but you really, really did an amazing job. Prior to joining the museum, Krishna has received professional certification in positive parenting, which focuses on positive discipline and redirection through positive behavior, and received her professional education and training from the Harvard Business School, the Institute of Philanthropy, and Fieldstone Leadership Network. Krishna, welcome, welcome, welcome. We'll have a formal ceremony after Keith gets done talking. Go ahead, Keith.
Well, thank you, President Andrew. I had to unmute myself there for a minute. Yes. You might remember that Nicole was a speaker at our lunch probably 2 months ago or something. And we were so captivated by her presentation that we had to try her meals after and got to know her a little bit and invited her to join our club, which she was very enthusiastic to do so. You know? So let me tell you something about Nicole. You know? Nicole Estrada is originally from San Diego and raised with her identical twin sister, Stephanie, by her parents, Patty and Paul Johnson. She holds a BS in business management and an MS in organizational leadership. Nicole met her husband of 9 years while working as a field collector at San Diego Gas and Electric, and together they are raising two sons, Dominic, 5, and Christian, 4. As a family, they enjoy spending time outdoors, going on bike rides, hiking, or swimming. Nicole is a corporate professional turned chef. For years, she showed her love for others through food. In 2017, she took an amazing leap of faith and resigned from her corporate job of 14 years and enrolled in culinary school. A year and a half later, she opened Fresh Creations, a catering and meal delivery service company based in beautiful San Diego. Nicole specializes in using food as medicine and creates health-conscious, plant-based meals with quality and flavor at the forefront of every dish. And I have to say, Chirito and I have been enjoying some of her meals delivered for the last couple of weeks, and they are incredible. We have no idea what we're eating. There's 15 different ingredients in each one, but they are scrumptious. You should give them a try. So welcome, Nicole.
Thank you very much. Honored to be here.
So, past President Keith, will you perform the ceremony?
Well, I thought you were doing that.
Oh, I don't know the words. You're the past president. I'm sorry. I misunderstood. You're still muted there, Keith.
Oh, sorry. You had said yesterday you were doing that, President Andrew, so I didn't.
No, I was introducing Krishna. I'm sorry. That was miscommunication.
Well, I've got nothing.
All right. Krishna and Erica, or Nicole, I'm sorry, Krishna and Nicole. Does anyone know what the...
Andrew, President, yes. Andrew, do you mind if I induct our two newest members to Rotary?
Please, please do, please do.
Krishna and Nicole, want to welcome you to the Escondido Rotary Club. It's really one of the storied clubs in our district. And it's an iconic club, as you have already experienced. We're so happy to have you. It's so important that we have new members come to our clubs because they lend a perspective and an energy and enthusiasm that helps shake things up, which is a good thing for us. I find it fascinating that you have joined the club during the pandemic. So you've never met the people in general in person, and we will meet in person again. And it'll be an amazing experience, not only for you, but for the club members that you've joined them during this time. And so I can't thank you enough. You will be welcome, by the way, you will be welcome at any Rotary Club around the world. And you'll hear in my talk, there are 35,000 Rotary Clubs around the world, including the Antarctica. So should you go to the Antarctica, you take your club's banner, flag, and exchange it with the Antarctica Club and bring it back. Because there's no club that I know in our district that has a flag from Antarctica. if we were meeting in person, I would ask the club members to come over and shake your hand, give you a high five or a fist bump or whatever, a hug, and welcome you. But instead, we're going to ask all the members of the Escondido Rotary Club to give you a great round of applause, even a standing ovation, for Krishna and Nicole. Welcome to the Rotary Club of Escondido.
Yay. Thank you both so much for joining. I am excited to be meeting you soon. Krishna, I've met you a couple times, I know, over at there, but thank you so much. And we are excited to have you with us. All right. Thank you. And one of the fun things that I get to do is the Rotarian of the Month for March of 2021. Every month, it is truly, as has been said before, this is one of the best parts of being president, is being able to recognize our members who are making a difference. And for March 2021, our Rotarian of the Month has really stepped up and found some innovative ways to help fund our club and what our mission for our club. So for March, Alex Keegan, you are our Rotarian of the Month.
Bravo.
Thank you. Very good. That's a surprise. Thank you.
It's got to be a surprise. All right, Christine, you're back up.
Yes, we have the honor of having the governor say a few words to those Escondido Rotarians who have supported the Rotary Foundation. So if you would go ahead and just click to the next screen. And Steve, if you'd say a few words. I have all three slides for the three different things we're honoring today.
Well, thank you, past district governor Christine. It's nice to see you again. It's nice to be back with the club. So the Rotary's mission since 1985 has been to eradicate polio throughout the world. And we're down to two countries, Afghanistan and Pakistan. And Pakistan has had only two cases since January 1. So we're getting there. It's much better than last year. And the Polio Plus Society members are the newest members who contribute $100 annually to eradicating polio. And this is a big deal. And I'm so happy and pleased to be able to acknowledge these charter members and our fight to eradicate polio. So our newest Polio Plus Society members are past District Governor Christine Monten, Bernie Blaney, Pizza Bill Smith, John Weitzen, past Assistant Governor Keith Rickenbacker, Charito Rickenbacker, and Nick Sulis. So thank you all very much for your contributions to making the world a better, safer place.
And next, Andy.
Oh boy. So this is awesome. So Paul Harris was a young man from Racine, Wisconsin, who went to Chicago. He was a lawyer, went to Chicago, and he wanted to contribute to his new community. He was a lawyer, and he got four other people together who were not lawyers, and they were business people. And so this was 116 years ago. And besides networking, that they were going to give back to the community. And the first project that they did was a outhouse in Chicago. And everyone knows that Chicago desperately needed an outhouse. And from such humble beginnings was our Rotary International. And Paul Harris became the first president of Rotary International. And in 1927, the Rotary Foundation was created. Paul Harris passed away in 1947. And in 1957, Rotary International recognized Paul Harris and his contributions by creating a Paul Harris pin to honor those who give to the Rotary Foundation. Now, when we give to the annual fund of the Rotary Foundation, 3 years from now, that money will come back to our district. Half that money will come back to our district, and that'll be used for global grants and district designated funds. So it's very significant, because to become a Paul Harris Fellow takes $1,000. It could be $1,000 at one time. It could be $200 a month. It could be $100 a month. But when you reach this level, you receive a Paul Harris pin to be a Paul Harris Fellow. And your club has contributed mightily to the Rotary Foundation, also to make the world a better place. So at this time, I'd like to acknowledge our newest Paul Harris Fellows, Keith Rickenbacker, Charito Rickenbacker, Vaughn North, Myrna North, Kurt Beyer, and Jay Grossman. Thank you all very much, and congratulations on reaching this milestone level.
And one more, Andy.
I know. Yes. I'm sorry.
It's all right.
Okay. No. So to become a major donor, to reach the major donor level, it takes contributions of $10,000. Could be $10,000 all at once, $1,000 a year for 10 years, $500, $200, whatever amount is given. When you reach the $10,000 level, it's very significant. It's a very significant contribution, and we recognize that in Rotary. And you'll be receiving a stunning glass etching for your contributions. And this is powerful money, as the Paul Harris Fellows are, and as the Polio Plus are. So it really is a testimony to the generosity of and beneficence of your club members and your club. So I want to thank and congratulate Laura Stees and Paul Van Elderen for your contributions to the Rotary Foundation. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Laura and Paul. You have stepped up mightily. Thank you very much. And all of our Paul Harris members and Polio Plus inaugural members, thank you for making our club proud of you. All right. And again, Christine, you get a lot of time this week, Christine. That's nice.
Well, sometimes that's how it goes.
Time for our fun song. And look, there's Steve dancing and singing.
Yeah, time for our fun song. Steve, you visited our club before, so you know we write a song. We do the lyrics to a tune of a song that the people know. And ordinarily, if you met with us at the California Center for the Arts, you'd hear everybody singing. Today, just pretend there's a little bit of an orchestra behind me, and we'll do it a cappella. Oh, Governor Steve, the clubs are calling from Escondido to San Diego. The months have flown with just 3 months till year is gone. So much to do, then you'll be asked to go. So come ye back when projects are in full swing. See what we do in winter, fall, or spring. It's proud we are to serve in Escondido. Oh, Governor Steve, for all you do, we thank you so. You've owned your own law practice since 1990. A civil litigator, yes, it's true. He's from the Del Mar-Solana Beach Rotary Club, a Paul Harris Society member too. So come ye back for fellowship and fun songs. We are the best at both of these, we think. The clubs have benefited from your leadership. Oh, Governor Steve, for all you do, we thank you so.
Woo, woo.
That was awesome. Hey.
Glad we did not all sing that together because I couldn't reach those notes.
I think you're ready.
I barely did.
I think you're ready for the opera, Christine. That was
I don't know. I'll be in the audience.
Thank you. Thank you,
everybody. Right. So, Christine, do you want to introduce Steve or are we just going to jump right in?
No, well, actually, the assistant governor is introducing the governor.
Assistant governor. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Good afternoon, Andrew and Escondido Noon Club. Thank you for having us.
Truly.
Now, I can't sing the bio that you just sang about, Steve, but I will give a little bit more here. Steve is a resident of La Jolla with his wife, Ava. They're native San Diegans. He's been an attorney since 1987 and has opened his own law practice in 1990. Today, he is a solo practitioner in the area of civil litigation. Steve has been a member of the Del Mar Solana Beach Club since 2006 and served as president 2013-2014. He's been to El Salvador twice with the club to work on international projects in the poorest Central American countries. He has also served at the stand down as a counselor and homeless for the military vets. Steve was an assistant governor from 2015 to 2018 and was chief assistant 2019 to 2020. He is a Paul Harris Society member and has been speaker at PETS, district training, and district conference events. At this time, I'd like to introduce Steve, District Governor Steve.
Thank Woo-hoo! You. Appreciate it. Thank you, President Andrew, past Governor Christine. For Krishna and Nicole and our guests that are with us today, I'm the district governor of District 5340 in the Rotary world. There are 525 districts, and I'm one of the governors. It's my obligation. We have 60 clubs in our district, by the way, that runs from San Diego all the way to the Arizona border. And we have 10 Rotaract clubs. And it's my responsibility to make a visit to each club and see how the clubs are doing and how offer my support and to lay out a vision for our district. And so that's the purpose of me being here today, as we have made the awards and inducted two new members. Before I get into the more formal remarks, I'd like to acknowledge some people. I'd like to acknowledge past District Governor Christine Montaigne. Now, Christine, having been District Governor, you know what this is like, and my respect for you grows tremendously each day that I'm governor. It really is quite an undertaking, and so thank you for having been District Governor and your support of me. It really means a lot to me. I think past president Jan Jones started when the pandemic was in the middle of her term or toward the end of her term when the pandemic hit, and we had to scramble to find a way to meet, and we had Zoom, and President Andy is an IT guy, and he got you set up, but you know, it was really challenging. And Jan, my hat goes off to you, and thank you for what you did to keep the club in connected and in place so that Andrew could take over in his year and do the great job that he's done. 3 years ago, I was an assistant governor and was up at PETS, the President-elect training seminar, where all the presidents of our Southwest region get together to get trained. And I had lunch with Paul McNamara at the time, as he was going to be the president-elect. And we had a nice visit and got to know each other. And it's amazing, in 3 years, you know, Paul became Mayor Mack and I became the governor. So, you know, out of these connections, interesting things can happen. But I want to pay special tribute and acknowledgement to President Andrew. And we started our journey a couple of years ago, and Andrew came over to our house for dinner. We met with all the presidents in the area. We thought that we would be able to meet in person, obviously, and that just hasn't happened and probably will not happen to the duration of President Andrew's term and my term. And we trained together at PETS, and we've stayed in touch during the year. And besides being a delightful guy, Andrew, you've done a tremendous job of leading your club, and I couldn't be prouder of you and the job you've done. You were vested with one of the really signature clubs of our district, and the job you have done in making it fun and keeping it fun and engaging everyone is just truly commendable. So I can't thank you enough for what you've done and what you've meant, not only to your club and not only to the district, but to Rotary International. You're a great example, role model for all of us. So thank you, Andrew. It's a funny thing, we have two new members and they came to you. One was a speaker and the other you met through a connection in Rotary. And I'm probably the least likely Rotarian that you're ever going to meet. You see, I was in a business network group that met every Tuesday morning at the Doubletree Hotel in Carmel Valley. And we met Tuesday morning at 7. And one morning, this woman in the group comes up to me. She says, "Steve, you should join my Rotary Club. It's great. We do fantastic things together, and you're going to love the people. We're such good friends." And she said, "The best thing is that we meet right here in this same room on Friday mornings. You'll love it." And I looked at her and I thought to myself, "You got to be kidding." I just realized, like, the last thing I need is another breakfast meeting to get up early and go somewhere. And I'm having this conversation in my head. And if I say no to her, you know, for sure she's going to bother me every week until I say yes. So I decided to put myself out of my misery. And I told her, "Okay, fine. I'll meet you this Friday and we'll just see how it goes." Now, mind you, I had never heard of Rotary before. I didn't know what they do or anything about it. But I figured it'd be easier. It's the path of least resistance. So that Friday morning, I got up and I went to the Doubletree Hotel and I made my way to the La Jolla room. And I looked inside the La Jolla room and she wasn't there. I turned around to see if she was coming in from the lobby. And she wasn't coming in from the lobby. And I thought to myself, "Yay, this is great. I can leave. I can tell her on Tuesday that I came Friday and she wasn't there. And I'll go to work and get some work done that I wouldn't have gotten done otherwise." Well, as I was turning to leave, two fellows from inside the room came and they asked me to come in and be their guest and join them for breakfast. It's kind of hard to beat a double team, and I needed to have breakfast anyway, so I went inside. I sat down with them, and a couple other people joined us. And I don't know, wherever it was, but it felt good to be in there, and the camaraderie and the fellowship was great, and we're having a nice time. I don't remember anything about the speaker, and I'm certain it's not as good as the speaker you're having today, but nevertheless, it was worthwhile. And as the meeting was coming to an end, the folks asked me to join them for their demotion party. And I asked them, "Well, I didn't know what a demotion party is, and where is it, what time, and that whole deal." And so the demotion party is when they roast the outgoing president And they say all these wonderful things about the incoming president because there's nothing like the next one up. I mean, they're the best thing. So they said, well, it's Sunday and it's at 5 o'clock. And they told me where it was. And it was around the corner from our house. So that Sunday, my wife and I did go to the demotion party. And I saw the people that I met on Friday. And I met some other Rotarians who weren't there on Friday and their spouses and significant others. And we had a really nice time. They were so warm and welcoming. It was like being with old friends. And as we were leaving, they came up to me and they said, well, we'd like you to come to our meeting this Friday and be our guest. So I did. I came that Friday morning and every Friday since. But that's not the end of the story. You see, I've never seen the woman who brought me to Rotary again in my life. She never came to another network meeting. She never came to a Rotary meeting. I've tried to look for her. My club has tried to look for her to let her know where my path has taken me. Anyway, as far as I'm concerned, she's a Rotary angel because there's no other way to explain how I got into Rotary. Anyway, the point of the story is anytime you have guests who come to your club or you have new members, continue to be the warm, welcoming club that you are. Because you never know if one day that guest or new member doesn't one day become your club president or even district governor. And that's how I got into Rotary. But that's not the big question. The big question is, why do I stay in Rotary? Why does anyone stay in Rotary? Simon Sinek, the business author and consultant, wrote a book entitled Start With Why. Sinek explores the most successful companies and the most successful people. For instance, everyone knows that Ford Motor Company makes cars, but do the people at Ford know why they make cars other than to make a profit? Well, we know that Rotary is made up of 35,000 clubs around the world with 1.2 million and 1.2 million plus two new members with a foundation endowment of $1.3 billion. Simon essays Apple's computer rise to prominence. The people at Apple, they don't come to work to make iPhones, computers, and watches, although obviously they do. They come to work to change the world. And Apple is anchored to this why. Their passion comes through in their products and company culture. And Rotary is the same way. We all want to change the world through service to others, service above self. And the Rotary Foundation is the engine that drives our district designated grant projects and our global grants. The foundation allows us to partner with Rotary clubs around the world to improve the lives of others, whether it's water projects, fighting disease, or maternal and children's health. And we know that participating in an international project makes a stronger, more committed Rotarian. A few years ago, I went with some members of my club to El Salvador to check on our projects that were funded in part by the Rotary Foundation. Our mission was to explore and plan future projects. Our emissary picked us up in her van. We were accompanied by two armed guards with machine guns strapped across their shoulders. You know, you can't tell my wife this, she'll kill me. She won't let me go anywhere again, like ever. So please, let's keep it between ourselves today. So our emissary, she drove us to a place you couldn't find on Google Maps, MapQuest, or Waze. There were dirt roads the whole way. There were no street signs or markers telling us how far we were from the farm school. And there were high trees and plants on both sides of the road. How we found the farm school is beyond me. But once we got to the farm school, we went into a room. It's concrete floor, there were cinder block walls. It was very stark, that's all there was. And we looked out on the crops that the people were growing. It wasn't exactly a site of vibrancy. And we can see the chicken coops where chickens were being raised, primarily for food, but hopefully to be able to be sold for a livelihood. From behind one of the walls, a short, stocky woman came out. She asked if there was a doctor in our group. Well, at least there was an attorney, because you can always use an attorney no matter where you are. And it was her good fortune that Dr. Art Mendoza was with us. When we told her that Art was a doctor, the woman went back behind the wall and brought out a little girl. Now, this little 5 or 6 year old girl had a lump on her cheek the size of a golf ball. Art examined the girl and said she needed to be seen right away at a medical clinic to have that lump excised and biopsied. Now, the clinic was about a 2 hour drive from the farm school. So we did what Rotarians do. We passed around the hat and raised the money to send the little girl and her mother to the medical clinic. A few days later, we got word that the tumor was excised and biopsied and found to be benign, that the little girl was in good shape and good spirits. You see, that's what we do as Rotarians. We help people we don't know. People will never know. We made that little girl's world so much brighter. Every day, in many ways, we change the world for good, for the better. This is just one example of people of action. That is my why. That is why I stay in Rotary. Like you, I want to make a dent in the universe. What is your why? If you haven't been part of an international project, I would encourage you to do one. We will be able to travel again, so we will be able to do projects around the world. Ask your club how you can become involved in an international project. And if your club is not involved, look around the district and see what clubs are. They would love to have you partner with them. And if that doesn't work for you, call me. I'll be happy to find an international project that's just right for you. As much as you will change the lives of others, the truth of the matter is, it is you who will be changed forever. I'd like to share with you my passion and vision for our district, and not just for our district, but for Rotary. There is an insidious evil in our country, and not only in our country, but around the world. And we must take this evil on and eradicate it, just like we have with polio. I am talking about human trafficking. There are three forms of human trafficking: organ trafficking, slave labor trafficking, and sex trafficking. Organ trafficking includes corneas, livers, and lungs. However, the most prevalent organ trafficked is kidneys. In the United States, the average wait time for a kidney is 3.5 years. And there are about 10,000 kidneys trafficked annually. In the United States, there are approximately 123,000 people awaiting a transplanted organ. See, there's a very low supply with a high demand. Poor, disadvantaged people sell their organs, compromising their own health in order to provide for themselves and their families. And this practice has got to stop, because people were not created to live like this. Human trafficking for slave labor, unfortunately, is very common today. Over 100 years ago, governments around the world condemned slavery to the history books. We would think that there is no more slave labor. Today, it is estimated that slave labor is very much present to more than 40 million men, women, and children, the population of California. These people are trafficked all over the world to work in restaurants, hotels, homes, factories, crop fields of cocaine, coffee, and the like. Often slave labor becomes the gateway to sex trafficking. In regards to sex trafficking, the average entry into sex trafficking is 16 years old. Now, to get to this average means that there has to be a lot of younger victims. And the average life expectancy of one who is in the game or in the life is 7 years. These are staggering, mind-numbing statistics. And sex trafficking is not like in the movie Taken with Liam Neeson, where the girl is physically kidnapped. Today, trafficking is done by the use of the internet. Exploiters troll the internet, going into chat rooms, finding impressionable teenagers who are lured to parties with compliments about their looks and promises of love. These kids are offered protection and financial security. Sex trafficking is a $150 billion a year industry worldwide. And this is a close second to the illegal drug trade. And there's a connection between these two activities. 100,000 girls and boys are trafficked daily in the United States, and California has the highest volume. In San Diego, sex trafficking is an $800 million a year business. This statistic is 3 years old. I have no doubt that that amount is even higher today. And there is a gang component to sex trafficking, where there are 110 identified gangs. These gangs are shifting their focus away from drugs and weapons to sex trafficking. Why? Because sex trafficking is less visible than drugs and guns. And we have to be wary of this trend. Gangs have learned that sex trafficking is a low-risk, high-yield criminal enterprise. What we in Rotary want to do is reduce the vulnerability of our children. We are partnering with our friends in law enforcement at the U.S. Attorney's Office and the District Attorney's Office. We are sharing information with these agencies when we learn about nefarious activities involving our children and students. We are collaborating with other nonprofits such as Free to Thrive, I-5 Freedom Network, and Rotarians Fighting Human Trafficking. I have tasked an anti-human trafficking committee to reach out to clubs like yours, offering ways and means to fight sex trafficking. David Oates, the past president of Club 33, chairs the committee, which comes under the Pathways to Peace Avenue of Service. There are 10 members of the committee from 8 clubs across the district. The committee has developed 3 impactful training videos that are available on the district website, rotary5340.org, rotary5340.org. These training sessions are outstanding and offer ways for each of us to become involved in helping survivors escape their exploiter and to get back into society. Each video is about an hour long. It's very compelling. I would encourage you to at least watch one of them. I watched all 3 at one time because it was just unbelievable what is happening and what we can do to make a difference. And speaking about getting back into the society, one of the challenges that a survivor of sex trafficking faces is finding employment. Often, particularly a young woman, has a solicitation crime on her record, which makes an employer reluctant to hire her. If you own a business or you know someone who owns a business, it would be incredibly helpful, at least to the survivor, to be granted an interview. No promises or guarantees of a job, just the interview. And that interview alone will go a long way to helping the survivor reclaim her self-worth and self-esteem. If this is something you can do, please let me know over the next few days, and I'll be happy to put you in touch with Danny Womack, who takes care of this part of our committee work. Education and awareness is the first step to wiping out this ancient modern scourge. We submitted a global grant to the Rotary Foundation that was recently approved for $70,000. This grant will do 2 things. One, it launches an advertising campaign with signage at the airport, bus stations, train stations, warning of a child who is being trafficked. The phone number of law enforcement is there on the sign so that we can report such an event right away. The second part of the grant will provide teacher training so that teachers will be able to identify the signs of a student who is trafficked. After all, the teacher may be in the best last position to help a student escape her exploiter. In this time of the pandemic, when most schooling is done by Zoom and at home, we know that there's been a 50% reduction in the amount of child abuse calls into the district attorney's office. And the reason is that more often than not, that an exploiter is a family member, and that the victim of trafficking is unlikely to want to call law enforcement on their family. So I'd like to conclude by offering some observations on the value of being in Rotary, the what's in it for me part. Studies have shown that volunteering helps people feel more socially connected, thus warding off loneliness and depression. Another study found that volunteering slows the cognitive decline often associated with aging. A survey by the health insurer Cigna in 2018 found that 54% of the people surveyed said that they were lonely. In 2020, 2 years later, the same survey found that 61% of the people surveyed said they were lonely. This is a disturbing trend, obviously. For loneliness is really about being disconnected from others and the world. Service to others is the antidote to loneliness. Service takes the focus off us and puts it on someone else. It reminds us that we have value to add and to give to the world. And this is where Rotary comes in. Rotary opens opportunities to serve, to repair the world, to heal ourselves. The Greek philosopher Aristotle once noted that the essence of life is to serve others and do good. Well, doesn't that sound like Rotary? By doing community service here at home and around the world, we lead a more meaningful, purposeful, driven life. And one of the hallmarks of being in a Rotary club like yours is the fellowship that we all enjoy. Being a part of our Rotary family is a sure cure for loneliness. We care for each other and those we serve. Thank you for being a big part of Rotary. Thank you for doing all that you do. Thank you for having me to your meeting today to share these ideas and thoughts with you. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Steve. Very inspirational. And I will just say to anyone who's in the room and has wondered what they can do to make a difference, they want a project, you don't have to do it all yourself. You have an inspiration, bring it up to somebody. We can work together and make it come real. And that's what we're trying to do. Don't wait for somebody to tell you what to do. Step forward with something that inspires you. And we'll make it happen. Absolutely. Thank you again, Steve. A very, very, very wonderful program.
Thank you.
Which, of course, we expected. But
I know, no pressure.
And by the way, I am so sorry about burning down your kitchen when you invited me over to dinner. I hope someday you'll invite me back again.
That wasn't you, Andrew. It was my wife.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I'll let you believe that.
Anyway.
My chief aide, Susie Callahan, is here. Today's her birthday. I just want to wish her by Zoom. Susie, happy birthday. Hope she's still here.
Yes.
And past district and governor-elect Dan Gensler was here. I just want to say hi, yep. Dan. In 3 months, pal, it's all yours. I'll give you the keys to the car.
There's Susie. Happy birthday, Susie.
Happy birthday.
Thank you. Good
nice that you'll be able place. To drink now, finally, right?
Yeah. Thank all you right. for that. A wonderful meeting. Thanks for being here, though.
This is shower thoughts from last week, because last week it was National Dog Day, but I still wanted to share this one. From a dog's perspective, you have always existed and you will almost always exist. So we'll ring out this meeting. Here's the bell.
That's great.
You guys have an amazing week. If you want to ask any questions of our district governor, he might hang out for a few more minutes.
I'm happy to stay as long as people are going to stay and ask questions or just say hi.
Yeah. And Kristen Bush, thank you for joining us again. Hope you can continue joining us. Go ahead,
Austin. Sorry, Andrew. I was going to say that it was very scary, especially the fact that in San Diego we have such a problem.
Yeah, it's really interesting, Aussie, that 80% of sex trafficking in San Diego is really homegrown. You don't see transmigration. You don't see people coming across from Mexico into San Diego, and you don't see people from San Diego going to Mexico or other states. It's all local based, and it is scary. I mean, if you have children, grandchildren, know who your kids and grandchildren are talking to on their phones. They're very clever. You know, these exploiters are very clever in the way they lure you to these parties, and that's how it starts. And the kids, you know, these are kids, they're teenagers, and their frontal brain hasn't fully functioned.
Yes.
And so they think the world revolves around them. So if they get themselves into a bad situation, they don't know who to turn to. They don't know how to turn to their parents or friends in law enforcement to help them out. So you're right, it is a very scary thing. I've had the privilege and honor of meeting victims who have survived trafficking, and they're normal regular people, but what they've experienced scars you for life. There isn't enough therapy to help them come around.
Absolutely.
It's just not the victim, it's the family, it's their friends and the community that's affected. That's why this is such an important issue.
I have a question.
Nick,
I was trying to look on the website to where those videos were. Being a pediatrician and having had patients, I'm a retired pediatrician now, but when I was in practice, that happened to one of my teenage patients. And I was wondering where on the district website you've hidden those videos.
I will make sure that they come to the top. They promised me, the folks who run the website, they would always keep it at the top. So I will call when we're done to make sure it gets up to the top. So give me a couple hours to get it back up there for you, okay?
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Good. Okay, Stephen, I'm going to leave. Thanks for your chat. Okay. Great program.
Thank you, I appreciate it. Thanks so much. So are you guys starting to have a discussion as to what it's going to look like when you meet in person, or anything from the performing arts as to allowing you to come in and meet in person, do hybrid meetings?
I started meeting it, Andy. I don't know whether you've been, I talked to Terry.
Right.
She's excited to get us back in.
Okay.
Very optimistic.
Good.
We will be back in at a luncheon, and she's already batting around the ideas of, are you gonna want service at the table, or do you want service at the buffet? It's not going to be a self-serve agenda, she's sure.
Right.
We're really excited to get back together face to face and sit around a table, even if it's only four of us, and just get back into the real momentum of Rotary, which is people with people serving others. So, by the way, thanks for the Pets conference. I was fortunate to attend, and Stephen and Dan and a lot of our leaders are right up there on their leadership thing.
It's great. It's a lot of fun. It really is, even if it's virtual. So when you go back into the Performing Arts Center, you know, we're limiting the number of people who come in person. Andrew, hopefully you'll be able to Zoom to those who can't make it, and therefore making it a hybrid meeting so they can stay connected. Maybe those who came 1 week will stay home the following week, and those who were home can come the next week. There's ways to make this work to get the fellowship back in person.
Absolutely, and yes, I haven't actually been in touch with Terry myself yet. I'm being leery because we're this close to the finish line.
Yeah.
And I don't want to push it and cause a fallback, but I'm going to give her a call in the next week or so. Now that as of April 1st, it's going to be a lot more people available to get vaccines. So I'm going to chat with her about what it's going to look like. It may take about a month to get up and running. I do know that our demotion is going to be in person. So at the very least, we have June 29th scheduled for the center. But hopefully we'll get back a little sooner than that.
Andy, do you want me to create a Google survey to see how our club members feel about opening back?
Let's just hold about another week or two, and let's see how the second half, this new vaccine rollout goes. Again, my personal opinion, and we can talk about it in board meeting, is I'd like to get us down to the next tier, which it looks like we might be able to do in the next couple of weeks, because I think that's where the center is open to a crowd the size that we were going to have. Otherwise, we're going to be too scattered in that room, and it may lose some of its power. But let's talk either in the board meeting or offline about that. I mean, for me, I don't see it happening till at least mid-May, just because it takes about a month to get everything up and running and get our speakers organized and everything. I'm feeling very cautious personally that we're so close to this finish line, and I don't want to mess it up by pushing to get back too soon.
You're right, Andrew. I was hoping and thinking that your motion party would be at some avocado grove or orange grove.
Yes.
Outdoors.
There's a thought.
Yeah. You have an awesome guacamole, I'm telling you.
You know, it could be like a wine, making wine. We could put avocados in the barrel and I'll stomp them, right? Exactly. Alex, let's talk some more about the survey. For me, I think we're looking at mid to late May as the earliest possibility, just because even if we said today, let's gear up, it's going to take about a month, month and a half.
Yeah, I'm just talking about to find out how the club members feel about it.
Yeah, no, I get that. I do. So let's talk some more about that. But and then as far as the hybrid meetings, yes, I've been thinking on that. My biggest challenge, Steve, with that is that I've been doing programs for 4 years now, so I need to work with Vaughn to help him figure out how to implement that, because I'm not sure that I'm going to want to be sitting on my computer during a meeting, every single meeting again.
No good deed goes unpunished, so
right.
You got to start training somebody to take you over for your position. Otherwise, you'll wind up like being a treasurer for the next 20 years.
Like Dan Sundquist, yes.
I would like to encourage anybody that wants to learn the ropes to do what Andy has done so well. If you know somebody,
are people who could do it better. Absolutely.
We do need to get organized as this moves forward so that we can be prepared to do those things. And I claim the age of 76 as being a partial release from heavy computer work, because that's the culture.
Right. But we will figure out a way to do these hybrid meetings. It's Steve, part of the challenge is actually the broadcast of the meeting itself, because it's such a large room, a computer camera is not gonna capture it. And so that's where my mind is.
You're right. But there are ways to work it. You know, yeah. On the president, on the speaker, and
yeah,
you know, that's at least
yeah
better than nothing.
I've got concepts, and Vaughn and I, since we're not doing anything on the 24th of April, maybe Vaughn and I will sit down and have a chat about what that looks like.
Andrew,
that could be your Rotarians at Work Day project.
Right? Andrew, what about involving the Rotaract Club at the university downtown in this?
Definitely a good idea. That's definitely a good idea. I think Vaughn helped me remember that's one of the avenues, but the actual physical logistics of it, you know, basically conceptually to me, we put a smaller laptop on the dais and have the camera on the speaker and the slide program they're going and all that. And then someone else would be on the other at another spot and toggling between speaker and slideshow.
Yeah, they could keep it entertaining.
Yeah.
whoever is speaking or conducting shouldn't have to worry about how do
running
I make
the program.
It's interesting.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's kind of, again, it, conceptually, I have the concept of how it works, yeah. But it's one or two people are going to have to, well, more than one person going to have to be involved. One person's going to have to create the program, load it on a computer, put a computer on the dais, and then another computer or tablet elsewhere is going to have to be toggling between slideshow and speaker.
I have
yes.
Oh, no, maybe you just answered the question and I wasn't listening because I was getting ready to ask my question. That was whether we would be able to possibly, if only half people were there, half people were listening on Zoom, can the people on Zoom be somehow participate? Is that what you were saying? We could see their faces there?
Yes. Yeah, depending on what view we show on Zoom, yes.
Like at church, you know, we used to, everybody had Zoom. We all did Zoom. Now we go back to church and some people listen, but now they aren't even seen. It's like they don't exist. So I think it'd be cool if the people at home existed at the center.
Yeah, and there are ways to do that. And there definitely are ways to do that. But again, the more layers you add, the more people you're going to have to add to manage the minute by minute.
Well, let's meet up. Thank you very much. Thank you for the song today. That was special.
Oh, that was Christine and she's gone already. Yeah. But yes.
So that was very nice. It was sweet.
It is.
I'll have it with my green beer next time I play the recording.
Well, it'll be posted on Facebook and YouTube soon, hopefully within a week. So you can share it with all your friends and family.
Well, I'm going to have them memorize it because that's it's the least I can do.
Exactly. All righty. Anyone else have any other comments? All right. I'm starving to death. I'm going to go eat lunch. So I'm going to shut down the meeting. Bye, Chirito. Mm-hmm. Steve, again, thank you. An amazing program, which is no surprise, but thank you.
Thank you all very much. Appreciate it. Take care.
Bye all.
Okay. Bye. Take care.
Thank you and goodbye.
Bye, Rick. Bye, Roy.